Welcome to Tuesday's edition of Renew Plus. I'm Pastor Tony. Thank you for joining us again today. And again, we're in our third week of our series we've entitled Highway 316. The love of God is the highway of the Most High. And we've looked at so many things already. And if you've just now picked up on these podcasts, I encourage you to go back the last couple of weeks and go back and hear what we've said so far. But we're going to go back over to the Ephesians 3 prayer again today. We've been in there the last couple of days in from last week and again yesterday. But I want to go back over there again today. This is a prayer that we should be praying for ourselves, for those around us, for our loved ones, because this is a Holy Spirit-inspired prayer. And if the Holy Spirit felt it valuable and worthy enough to include these in the writings of Paul in the book of Ephesians, I think we need to take note of them and use those prayers for us, because we need the same thing that that the saints in Ephesus did. So Ephesians chapter 3, we're just going to pick it up from verse 14 and move on down. Once again, we've already given some commentary on this, so I won't repeat everything again. But verse number 14, Paul is praying and he's writing here. He says, "For this reason, I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, for whom the whole family in heaven and on earth is named, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might through his Spirit in the inner man." Again, notice, very first thing he prays right here is that we would, according to the riches of God's glory, that we would be granted strength and be strengthened with mighty power in our inner man by the Holy Spirit. The reason that is first on the list is because without that strengthening on the inside, we're not going to be able to receive and accept the reality of the things he's about to pray out and unload on us right here, okay? So verse number 17 goes on to read, "That Christ may dwell in our hearts, your hearts, our hearts, through faith, that you being rooted and grounded in love." Now, again, notice that he's talking about being rooted and grounded in the love that God has for us. Now, being rooted and grounded is more than just being acquainted with, more than just having a brief one-time experience with. When he's talking about being rooted and grounded, that means we continually go over here and we are constantly having our roots going wider and deeper into the love of God, and we're being grounded more and more continuously by this progressive revelation and understanding of God's love for us. So you're not just going to have a one-time thing with this where you're going to know everything and comprehend the vast magnitude of the multidimensional love of God. No, this is why this prayer is prayed continually, like the Ephesians 1 prayer where Paul said, "I pray this without ceasing for you," because this revelation, this understanding is progressive. It's ongoing. You're going to see it more next week than you do right now, more next year than you do now. And I can say that I've been pretty faithful over the last 30 years to pray, 30-something years to pray these prayers, and my understanding and comprehension has been progressively growing and developing in God's love for me. Now, I can tell you also, it doesn't come overnight. It doesn't come in a week. This is pretty much a lifetime of having roots going deeper and you being more grounded in the love of God. Now, verse number 18, "that we may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and length and depth and height." Again, notice that the love of God is substantive. It has spiritual substance to it. It's more than two-dimensional. It's more than God just leaning over the balcony of heaven and saying, "I love you." No, there is actually substance to it. It has width, length, depth, and height. Then it goes on to say in verse 19, "to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge." Now, this word "know" here is not just intellectually knowing about something. This is actually an intimate knowledge of the love that Christ has for us, the love of God. Now notice that the love of Christ passes knowledge. Another translation says passes natural knowledge or passes mere knowledge. Now what is he saying right there? How can we understand it? How can we know it if it passes knowledge? What he's talking about is natural knowledge. Knowledge gained from the outside in through the intellect, through the natural senses. Now, there are things that we can learn about the natural realm just intellectually or naturally, because we have certain things that we can compare it with. But with the love of God, with the width, length, depth, and height of the love of God, it is beyond anything in the natural realm we can compare it with. There's nothing in the natural realm that I can take you to that's going to compare the multidimensional magnitude of God's love for us. That's why it has to be spiritually discerned. That's why it has to be spiritually taught and received. That's why you have to have supernatural help to understand it, because there's nothing in this natural realm, in this natural order, that can compare the kind of love that God has for us with it. You know, I could take you to maybe some kind of telescope somewhere, the highest powered telescope that they have on the earth, or we could even hook up maybe with the Hubble telescope, which is in outer space. It kind of gets outside of our atmosphere. It can see further, and kind of pictures that it sends back are just awesome of our universe, things that you can't see with the naked eye or with any other telescope on the earth. But I can tell you, even as strong as the Hubble telescope is, it cannot reach the end of the universe. So we could look at pictures there. We could look, you know, at views and camera shots from the Hubble telescope. But even the as far out as it can see, it's not seeing the end of the universe. In fact, all accounts say that the universe is still expanding at the speed of light. But even if you could see the ends of the universe, it is not in comparison to the height of the love that God has for us. I could take you to the Pacific Ocean, and we could see, and we could go out into the Pacific Ocean, you know, take a cruise out there somewhere, and all you could see around you, you could get out beyond land where all you see around you is just water, just a horizon of blue water all around you. But that would not compare with the width of the love that God has for us. We could get in some kind of souped up kind of submarine that we could go to the depths of the ocean somehow. You could go down to the farthest depths of the ocean, and that's still not going to be a fair comparison, a right comparison with the depth of God's love for us. I think I get my point across here. It can't be intellectually known and understood, because there's nothing in the natural realm that our senses can touch that are going to compare the kind of love that God has for us with. So that's why he says it's got to be something from the Holy Spirit inside out. It goes beyond just natural knowledge. He says it passes to know, verse 19 again says, to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now notice, the only thing that's keeping us from being filled with the fullness of God, saints, children of God, is just a greater capacity to receive. And our capacity to receive is all contingent on our growing in the knowledge and the understanding, the comprehension of the width, length, depth, and height, and knowing the love that God has for us. I tell you, that is just awesome when you start thinking about that right there. The more you understand, the more you grow in your understanding and comprehension of the love that God has for us, the kind of love that God has for us, then that increases your capacity to receive, and then you're able to walk in a greater realm of the fullness of God in your life. In other words, greater peace, greater joy, more abundant life, greater things, the greater plan that God has for you is all found on that right there. Highway 316 is going to lead us to these destinies that God pre-established and foreordained for us before the foundation of the world. And it goes beyond, again, your natural comprehension. But it's all based right there on us knowing and comprehending the love that God has for us. Now, Notice verse 20, it says, "Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us." Now notice again, this is at the end of this prayer right here. You know, that we can be filled with the fullness of God once we know we have a greater capacity or have a greater comprehension and knowledge of the love that God has for us. But notice that he finishes up in verse 20, says, "Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly." Now he could have said abundantly, that would have been pretty good. But notice, again, Paul is grasping for human language, human words here, descriptive words of the kind of thing, the kind of plan that God has for us. He says that he is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us. Notice that the power is already there. The ability is already there. The power and the provision for God to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think is already available to us in the Holy Spirit, in our own human spirit. That's what he's saying right there. So really, if we're not walking in greater measures of the plan of God, if we're not seeing God just blowing our socks off with something awesome in our life, we're not just in constant awe of something God is doing in our life. And it's not all spectacular, and it's not all material. You understand that. But if we're just not, you know, if many times we're blaming this on God when we shouldn't be blaming this on God at all. This has everything to do with our capacity to receive, not with God's willingness to give. God is obviously willing to give because he's already deposited on the inside of us all the power and provision to do an awesome plan and an awesome thing in our life. The only thing that's hindering it is our capacity, our small, limited capacity to receive. But this prayer is about expanding that capacity to receive. This prayer is all about causing that capacity to receive to be enlarged. So, you know, like we read over in Isaiah 54 the last couple of weeks, where he says, "Enlarge the place of your tent dwelling." See, that's the capacity to receive. It's not just the tent dwelling itself. It's our capacity to receive more of the fullness of God, more of the plan of God, our ability to walk out the plan of God to a greater measure. And it's not God's fault. You know, we just blame God for it. We just say, well, it must not have been the will of God. He's telling us right here, it is the will of God for us. He's already put it on the inside of us, but we're not walking in the reality of it. We're not walking in the fullness of it because we're not seeing the fullness or the multidimensional magnitude of God's love for us. And that's why it's so important to pray this prayer and grow in this, be rooted and grounded in the love that God has for us. Now, let's go over real quick to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. I believe these scriptures will go right in line with this. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this. We could be back over here again later on in some coming weeks. But notice in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse number 9. It says, "But as it is written," now this is a quote from the Old Testament. It says, "But as it is written, eye has not seen, nor ear has heard, nor has entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who love him." Now notice, according to the Old Testament, now that's before they were born again, before they had the new birth experience and the Holy Spirit residing on the inside of them, that basically their knowledge and understanding was limited to what could pass through their natural eyes, through their natural senses. But he says, what eye is not seen, nor ear is heard. In other words, externally, what is previously unknown and not received by men, nor is entered into the heart of man, the things which God has prepared for those who love him. In other words, what he's telling us is, again, God can do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or think, above what we previously seen and known and experienced in our life. And God's put a power and a provision on the inside of us to do that, but it requires a greater comprehension of the love that God has for us. Now, he goes on to verse 10, it says, "But God has revealed them to us through his Spirit." Notice that. We're not in the dark about these things anymore in the new covenant because God is revealing these things that God has prepared for us who love him. He has revealed those things to us through his Spirit. "For the Spirit searches all things, Yes, the deep things of God. So in other words, the Holy Spirit plumbs the depths of the purpose and plan of God in his heart, the love of God that he has for us, and then he comes and conveys that and reveals that to us. He takes the cover off, the veil off, so that we can see the same thing that God's seeing. Boy, that's why Paul said, I am overwhelmed with the immensity of this awesome plan that God has for us. He's looking into these things. He wrote this too. He was looking into this. He said, it's not naturally known or understood. It has to be spiritually known and understood and comprehended. Again, my time is out. I don't know. I wish we could just keep on going, but you'll just have to join us again tomorrow. If you'd like additional resources and materials, go to tonycowan.org. We'll pick this up tomorrow. We'll see you then.